I can certainly tell you that whether it's in Syria or in Lebanon or in Iraq or in Iran, there has also been relief that a man like Qasem Soleimani is no longer, because it's important to remember, and it's important for Americans to know that he was also responsible for the deaths of thousands across the region. He was very much involved in leading Iran's expansionist regional policy in the region, and that meant conflict across the region.
The counter-argument that I've heard from Fox's Tucker Carlson, notably right there in primetime on Fox News, is that there are a lot of bad guys in the world, a lot of killers in this world, and is it always in America's interest to take action against them? Let me just play what Tucker said on Friday night, because he burst the propaganda bubble on Fox with a really clear anti-war stance, and then I want to get your all's reactions. Here's what he said.
No one in Washington is in mood for big picture questions right now, questions, the obvious ones, like, is Iran really the greatest threat we face, and who's actually benefiting from this, and why are we continuing to ignore the decline of our own country in favor of jumping into another quagmire from which there is no obvious exit?
We know that in the past, Tucker has been persuasive with President Trump. Right now, though, it seems Trump is listening to Sean Hannity and others on Fox who are urging him to show what they call strength in the region. Jasmine, I'm just curious what your reaction is. Hearing that kind of commentary on American television, how do you view it from Istanbul? You know, because there are not a whole lot of voices like Tucker on Fox News who might be telling the president to be careful.
Right, of course. And the thing is, I mean, as Kim said, the reaction in the region has been fairly varied. You have some people who are cheering this action on, some people who are really afraid of what the consequences might be for others in the region. You know, one of the things that the president has done, and one thing that I wanted to highlight here, is that the president took this action in Iraq without, you know, again, it's like vintage Trump, without alerting our allies, without giving anybody a heads up, without really taking into account the people in the region who could be affected by this kind of escalation. So that's the first thing that I wanted to highlight, is that it's completely dehumanizing in the way that he looks at people in the region, not taking their safety into account, not taking their livelihoods into account. And that's a dangerous thing for any U.S. president to be doing in the region. But secondly, I want to get back to the point about strategic communications that you mentioned. It's incredibly important at a time like this to have direct communications, behind-the-scenes communications at a very high level between two countries that have such a high level of tension between them. If you'll remember, Brian, in 2016, about I think a week before the Iran nuclear deal was about to be implemented, 10 U.S. Navy sailors erroneously went into Iranian territorial waters and were captured by the IRGC. Now, because we had direct that could have gone really, really badly. It could have scuttled the deal. It could have escalated really quickly. But because we had direct communications between Secretary Kerry and Zarif, within 24 hours, those soldiers were released. Now, you have to ask yourself, if this kind of thing happened today, would a Twitter war solve that? Or, you know, what would that lead to without any kind of communication with the regime? It's incredibly reckless, and it doesn't allow for any sort of de-escalation. A lot of people are talking about what an escalation could look like, but what does a de-escalation look like without proper communications between the two sides? And then finally, just really quickly, I mean, Tucker Carlson is talking from a U.S. perspective. The American people did not elect President Trump to go to war in the Middle East. He was campaigning on a strategy or a promise of leaving the Middle East. People see him getting more and more involved without any sort of a plan or a strategy, and they're rightly, you know, worried about it.
Jason, there's often a critique of cable news that says that the banging of the war drums is constant on television, on cable news. Are you hearing that? Are you seeing that in this instance, that the media is incentivized to promote the notion of war and to hype up people's fears?
Well, I think we have to check ourselves against hyping fears. Our responsibility is to clearly, concisely report what's going on in a region that's far from home. And one that we don't often understand very well, and parse out truth from fiction. I hope that we're able to do that in the days and weeks to come. To Jasmine's point about that moment right before the nuclear deal was implemented, those were the last days that I was in prison in Iran, being held by the IRGC. I remember seeing on Iran state television from my prison cell that American soldiers had been American sailors had been abducted in Iran, and I worried that this would be a sort of a death blow to any potential negotiations for my own release. And I remember my captor, an IRGC captain, coming to me that day, and he, my main interrogator, telling me that that this was a good sign, that that I'd be out sooner because the U.S. and Iran were negotiating over key issues. As Jasmine rightfully points out, we don't have those lines of communications. We still have Americans in prison in Iran, and this could spiral out of control in ways that we can't even imagine right now.